out of Gotham, a crazy podcast about DC, with your host E-Rock and PD. When we speak up, get your geeks up, cause you know you about to get geeked up. So sit back, relax, and get comfy. Lose your mind like Solomon Grundy, and listen to a show that won't be forgotten, coming straight out of Gotham.
Out there, I couldn't come up with a Dune pun on the spot, so I just ruined it. So welcome everyone in the House of Holzman to another episode.
Arrakis.
Whatever the hell it's called. Arachnids. There, you could already guess where this is going. Welcome to another episode of Strand of the Gotham, episode 145. We are a fandom pop culture podcast and a proud member of the Batman Podcast Network, hosted by batmanonfilm.com. to please check out everybody else other than the Batman Book Club, head on over to batmanonfilm.com, clicking the podcast drop down and seeing what everyone has to offer, because they do a lot of great shows. There's a lot of great places on the network. Check out your fandom, your nerddom, and hang out and listen to some podcasts. I'm trying to think, who's a big podcast head? Not Lauer. Lauer runs the podcast. JJ Hodges. There we go. Listen to JJ Hodges' comic. He does a bunch of podcasts and stuff. JJ's got good stuff. So anyway, I am your senior contributor from the other side of the Hudson River for BatmanOnFilm.com, Peter R. Vera. And today we're recording on March 3rd, 2024. And we have a very special show for you today. We have a very, very special guest today. But before we get into that, I'd like to remind you, if you guys take the time to rate and review this podcast on Apple Podcasts, we read your review on air, you have entered and won the Straight Outta Gotham monthly contest, so please do that. And now let me introduce my partner in crime, the Duke of the House of Holzman, the champion of Long Island, the one, the only, my best friend, Eric Holzman.
Hello, Pete. How are you, brother?
How are you? I'm good.
Yeah, exciting week for this show, I think. At least for me, anyway. we're gonna be talking about Dune. So I'll just put it out there, Dune 2.
I mean, anyway. That's the only topic, right? it's the topic that's taken over the Twitter world.
Yeah, that and Sydney Sweeney, which we were talking about before, but we won't get too much into her.
That's a terrible
choice of words. we won't talk too much about her on this episode, but yeah, they've kind of been the two. And of course, another thing we'll discuss later that we've been discussing coming up, which is, of course, Superman, but...
Yes, the never-ending topic of Superman.
Yes, but we also have a special guest with us today, and he should have been on much, much sooner, so I'll take complete blame for this, but we ran a contest back in the summer, actually, last summer, and August we decided on a winner, and we said his name on air, I think. Yeah, we said his name on air, I remember, and we
he won.
We thanked him.
Announced it,
and it's been mostly my fault trying to get a time where he can come record, but we're finally making it happen. So first, we want to thank you for your patience, but Andrew, come on, please.
Hello, man. Hello.
Like bringing him on stage. The spotlight's here. Here you go.
Yeah, so first, we're getting into
hanging
it
out.
Now. Yeah,
hanging out post Dune. That's basically what we're doing.
Yeah, right.
But first, I want to, of course, thank you for taking part in that contest. Number one,
yeah,
we got some really good submissions, but yours was the best of all of them. And Pete and I both agreed, and we were like, we need to have him on.
Yeah. So now you can explain why you like Gotham. And
here we go. The one defender on Batman and film of Gotham.
There you go.
You know what? This was the only show ever that I knew about before it started, and I watched all the way to the end. Like, I was so excited for it to happen, and I enjoyed it the whole way through, and I was sad that it was over, but I feel like what I really got two main things out of it. One, it was exciting to see a Gotham without Batman, but building a Gotham that needed Batman. And it's not the best version of that story. That's not the, that's not rewriting the book. It's been told before, but I enjoyed watching that happen and, seeing Jim Gordon like pre-year one, essentially, try and fight corruption in Gotham, like, without the backup. I thought that was interesting. And then to see some of the villains, like, I think we all, you know, we know Batman's origin story. We've seen it 50 times now. But to see what how some of these villains came to be, and now granted, some of those villain stories were not not the best. some of them were messy and really weird. But some of them were really good. And I'm going to be honest with you, Peter, every time this show that shall not be named comes up, you actually say something fairly good about it. You're like, oh yeah, I kind of liked that part. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. That was kind of good.
It's not a whole mess. There's points where it's halfway decent. I'll give it credit when it's due, but it's still the worst thing in the world.
I think they suffered from I think the original concept was a procedural show as a cop show. So then it would be like a Criminal Minds or something like that, but just set in Gotham. So then all this weird stuff starts happening. And I think they moved away from that. And that's when they started to bring in Bruce Wayne more. And I don't necessarily hate that characterization of Bruce Wayne, because it's a very unexplored part of his story. But there were also some very weird Bruce Wayne choices in there that was like, I don't know if I agree with this, but it's interesting. it's interesting to watch. Yeah. But in preparation for being on this show, I did watch one Gotham Knights.
All the way through. Which one did you watch?
What do you mean? The show.
Which episode? Do you watch the whole series?
I watched the whole thing.
Oh, at least you watched like an episode. I was like, okay, cool. Oh, no. Because I would give you credit. I still give you credit.
I watched the whole thing. And Batwoman season 3.
Isn't Batwoman season 3 like at least halfway decent?
Oh, boy.
You said it once about Gotham Knights, that it's so far away from the source material that you can actually kind of enjoy it for kind of what it is. And I think that's true about both of those shows. Batwoman is trying to be a little bit more to some source material, but then they just did some weird stuff. But again, it was far enough away that I'm like, all right, I'll just enjoy these weird name drops and weird plot points. It's like, okay.
Did you like the Ivy stuff in season 3?
Yes, the Ivy stuff was strong. The Ivy stuff was strong.
That's definitely probably the best part of the season.
I always like when they introduce a blimp storyline too, and that was like the end of the season, right? I was like, all right, cool blimp story, level blimp story in Gotham.
Yeah, no, it was good. That was they did a little blimp too, which was nice.
So if the argument against Gotham is that they were trying to do too much Batman stuff and fell on their face, I guess I'd rather have that than whatever happened in Gotham Knights or Batwoman season 3. I guess that would be my elevator pitch, but
yeah, I mean, you know, we're still just talking about bad TV. Literally just comparing shit to diarrhea. Like, I'm sorry.
Gotham Knights. I just remember watching each week, and I felt weird that I was kind of making a point to watch this show every week after the first one. But I'm like, I said I was going to watch it, so I'm going to watch every episode. I'm going to go through it. And the more you go on, it just gets further and further away from anything I'd ever known. Mm-hmm. So I was like, okay, this is not even a show about these same people. Let's just keep watching it. And I mean, it was bad, but I didn't hate it because of that. Like, it didn't pull me from anything that
at like one point they just had to honor like a Batman movie in every episode. They had like one scene that honored a Batman movie in every episode. And I was just kind of like, yeah, okay, this is better than nothing.
I think the worst episode was the first one, because it feels like they wrote a whole show, but they didn't know how to get rid of Bruce Wayne. And so they just chose the worst way to get rid of him in episode 1. So then they could do the rest of the show. Still didn't make sense, but it was like, it was like, I don't know how you're building a show on that concept. They needed to, but I, whatever. It was a weird, a lot of people probably jumped off because of how Bruce Wayne was dealt with in episode one.
Yeah, it was, they made some interesting choices. I don't know what was worse, the mask for Gotham, the end of Gotham, or the mask when it showed dead Bruce Wayne. Like, they were both pretty bad. The one on Gotham Knights. So,
oh man.
But we got that glorious body shot of that pizza abs for the Gotham Batman. That was
why was there an X?
I have no idea. But it looked like somebody just sliced a pizza.
It was, yeah. So, oh man.
But I'm glad I can look back at these things and laugh and not be a grump about it, to be brutally honest, because that would be miserable. I'd rather be like, can we make a drinking game out of this? Like, post-Madam Web, I'm making all bad content drinking games.
Yeah. There you go. That's what you do with bad content. That's exactly what you do.
That's it. So I'm going to have a shot every time somebody brings up the Court of Owls in a Batman show.
Which happened in both Gotham Knights and Gotham. They were
being hammered.
Yes, that's true. So how did you stumble upon our show? I'm just curious.
Oh, that is... So I stumbled upon all of the Batman on film stuff through the Batman. The Batman movie came out, and Bill and Lauer were on the Social Hour doing the chapter by chapter. And I was like, oh, here's a group of people that love this movie like as in depth as I do, to go chapter by chapter, right? And Pete, I think you were on one of the episodes where it was near the end of the movie, I don't remember which one, but you were actually, you had watched the next scene, so you were talking about the wrong scene, and they were like, whoa, we're not there yet. And you knew the movie so well that you were able to talk about the previous scene as well. Because
I remember that episode. Yeah,
I've seen the same scene
for like 2 days, yeah, and I watched the wrong thing.
and you're like, yeah, I just know this whole movie so well. And I'm like, okay, well, he gets it. Like, because I thought the same thing. I was like, I don't care which episode I'm listening to. I know this movie so well. I can just hear somebody talk about it. So I was like,
That's strange for a movie that's been out for like 2 weeks.
I know.
So I was like, yeah, this is a group of people that I could listen to for a while. So then obviously you plugged this show and I started listening, and I was like, yeah, they have a pretty healthy back catalog. And so then I just started listening. And the interesting part is I was listening back when you started, so I listened to every episode, and the first episode that I listened to in real time was when you announced this competition. So I was like, nice. Oh shit, I caught up right at the right time. So that really worked out.
So you have been reading the Book of Holzman, you know all the feats, the greatness.
Yeah, I am. To be honest, over Christmas, he was in. He's not right here. You were in Florida, and you were messaging me about when to do this show, and I made a Rusty Piers reference that I don't know. Rusty Piers. I don't know, because I was like, I think I made a joke like you were creating an epilogue for your book, and the Rusty Piers back there and back again, or whatever.
Yeah, I remember that.
You didn't comment on it at all. So I was like, I don't know if he doesn't remember what Rusty Piers is trying to forget what Rusty Piers is.
I have so many nicknames. And so many
Rusty, Rusty Piers. I remember Rusty Piers. Rusty Piers was a fun one. That was good. Yeah. Yeah. Eric's, there's no feat too big. There's no legend too big. He's such an accomplished man. I just don't understand how he just doesn't get it in all day, every day. Like, it's just like, that's just a man whose talent shouldn't be wasted. You know? That's my opinion, and that's why he's here. And it's a gift for all of us to listen to this.
Really, there's only so many hours in a day. That's why. I mean, I can't. You know.
I mean, like,
it's hard sometimes.
Like, I expect to, like, when I finally go on to Eric's castle and I meet him on the island, like, I imagine it's going to kind of be like a Moat and Joe and like Mad Max Fury Road. There's just going to be like just rows of women just waiting for him.
Yeah.
Just like that.
Oh boy. If only.
But one of the crazier anecdotes was, you actually mentioned it on the show because I think Lauer told you about it, because I commented, but when Holzimon was starting, you guys were talking about Carmen, the opera. There's some adaptation or something like that. And
yes,
I have my degree in music, and my wife is actually an opera singer. So
I know very well.
Yeah. So during that episode, I was like, oh, cool. They're talking about Carmen, right? It was like something a little bit outside, but I know. And Pete, you said, because Eric knew what Carmen was, you said, Holzimon, read. And the fact that read was the dictation made me laugh so hard. And I was driving. And I was like, it's like this episode is dangerous because it just made me laugh really, really, really hard at Holzimon, read.
Holzimon's a good one. Holzimon smash is another one. Those are also catchphrases. You know, when Eric talks, sometimes I just see word bubbles, and that's really where this appears from. He's really an inspirational man. You put that man in front of a green wall, and anything can happen.
I remember Melissa Barrera was in that, right? Yeah, so that's probably why we've talked about it, because she was in Scream, and
she's been in the headlines lately.
So I think that's why that was a story that came across and Pete triggered it up. I mean, I know the movie didn't do well. I know.
Yeah,
that.
I don't. No, I didn't. But I didn't see it.
That's cool to know, though. That it's weird. I don't know much about opera, but that's an opera I've always known throughout my life. So
that's one very, of the very, ones.
Yeah, it's one of the bigger ones. But that's cool, man. And then that's cool that your wife's an opera singer. That's awesome.
Yeah, I you know, Eric fancies himself a singer himself.
I can sing, but I'm not an opera singer.
Yeah. not an opera singer, but Eric was almost an idol. I mean, Batman Forever, Kiss from a Rose.
I did try out, yes.
You know, Eric.
I tried out, sure.
Didn't you try out in the greater Chicago area anyway?
I did, actually. I tried out in Soldier Field.
It's all connected, right? Yep. That's just like the new DCU. Everything's going to be connected. It's
221, whatever it takes. Eric Holzman.
This was destined to happen.
It was. And then there's the Lauer connection. You have the Carusos. You know, this isn't by accident, you know, all this stuff. This is the power. You ever hear the power of attraction? This is the power of Holzman.
Oh, Jesus, yep. God.
Can you imagine Eric on like a rock wearing a loincloth like he's He-Man?
That's what I was saying. You make me sound like
well, I mean, you're sculpted like an Adonis, so
yeah, okay. I'm sculpted like Mario from Super Mario Brothers.
Who is a man of many championships and women, so that's He is dating. We're talking about a plumber who's dating a princess. I think he's doing okay.
Yeah. Well, he's kind of thinned out during the years. When he first was introduced, he was this plump little fat thing in Donkey Kong, right? So
He's a little upset.
Fat version of
his little brother's taller and thinner. You know, he's probably a little intimidated by Luigi.
So, wow, we're really going off the rails early, but
the power of Holden.
All right, so yeah, dude, thanks for coming on. Hopefully you have a fun time with us while we discuss our normal slate of topics, which you were briefed on. You got the rundown, so you know things we're either going to talk about or might talk about. We don't always get through all of them, specifically because this specific show, we're going to be talking about Dune 2. We're going to be going to spoiler territory in it. I'm not doing a non-spoiler show. We're not going to do it again.
No holds back. No holds Holzman.
So we're going to talk about it. There's a lot to talk about. This is it's a 2-hour and 46-minute film. It's a very dense film. He goes to a lot of places in this.
Would you, Eric, would you yell at somebody who said you just saw a 3-hour movie? If someone's like, oh, like you saw Dune, like, oh, I mean, I saw it 3 hours, you know, it was 3 hours. Would you get up to be like, no, it wasn't 3 hours. It was 2:45. I'm just asking.
No, I would not get upset.
My buddy Luca got a little upset with me. I was like, yeah, it was 3 hours. He's like, no, dude, it was 2:45. I was like, semantics, bro. Like, come on. We've been called to round up after 5 for how long? I'm taking this and running with it. It's 3 hours.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a long movie. I mean,
I don't think it felt long.
It didn't, though.
To be honest with you.
It was good pacing, in my opinion.
It didn't. So we'll do first reactions first. Mm-hmm. That makes sense. But we'll do like initial reactions. That's what I meant to say. Initial reactions first. So, Andrew, you're the guest. I'll let you lead. What was your initial reaction from seeing Dune 2?
Project. Use your outdoor voice.
Yeah. Yeah. I liked it. I liked it a lot. I, living on the Twitter sphere, you know, everybody said it was the best movie ever made. And, you know, so I I went in with those expectations. Shout out to Nico Caruso. But, no, but it was really good. I saw the length and I was like, oh, that's very long for a sequel. And I was worried about like the sequel problem of like, this is all going to be built up for a eventual third movie. And it's not going to be, it's just going to be people walking around and talking, like setting up something else that we're going to see, you know, 2-3 years. And at the beginning, I got more and more nervous as that was happening, but then all the cool stuff started happening. And I was like, okay, this is good. This is a very good sequel. Like everybody's saying the production was obviously crazy high. Like the first one, like, I don't want to get too ahead of myself, but a lot of people are saying this is like the closest thing we've gotten to Lord of the Rings since Lord of the Rings, as in this is a favorite story of people, and they're taking copious amounts of time and money to do it right so that it can be like the thing. Like you can have like the crazy box sets and everybody be like, you know, they can hold up Dune as like, here's this cool book and here's this.
They're going to make so much money off that stuff.
Yeah.
Like Mondo poster. I mean, you saw the popcorn buckets. Like, yep. Yeah, this is going to be.
I got one.
You did? You bought a fleshlight?
I did. I bought the fleshlight bucket, yes.
This is going to be a merch machine. Like, I'm with you 100%.
Yo, actually, speaking of merchandise, in the theater that I went to, they were selling Paul Atreides action figures. I've never seen action figures in a theater. Nice. Like, it was like next to the concessions. I didn't look at who it was, but. I should have.
But they look like legit, like Joe. Like,
yeah,
like,
I mean, like, they were. Oh, I think they were. Cool. I think they were six, 7-inch figures. Like it wasn't small.
Oh, nice.
And they had like different versions, like one with like the hood and one without the hood. Mm. And I'm like, man, they're really doing up the merchandising.
My comic shop, Main Street Comics in Milltown, New Jersey, they recently had like this old Dune worm on their toy shelf. It was interesting, and like it was cool to see it. I was like, because you mentioned like how people love the story and how they go back. Like obviously they made that crazy 80s movie that like people like half. Like, I don't Lynn. Know. Like I don't think most people like it, to be honest with you, right? Like
it wasn't good. No.
No.
Wasn't
okay. Good. I actually kind of want to watch it now to compare the three of them. You know.
Mm-hmm. I wouldn't tell you not to watch it. I'm just warning you. It's not.
Yeah. Good. No. No. Okay.
So, but continue.
No, yeah, I liked it. I'm excited for the third one. I thought it was a good sequel. It was good. I'm excited.
Is it getting a third one?
It's
undecided. Okay. There is another. I mean, the original book was the first two movies, so that that part's
like
done.
There's a lot of story to tell here, right?
Yeah, there's a large series of books in the Dune catalog, but the next one is called Messiah, and Denny has talked about wanting to do that movie.
Yeah,
I think he's gonna do it.
So I think he is too. I definitely think that's
gonna make bank.
Yeah,
I think this is
this movie. Everyone's been talking about the next movie post COVID that's gonna make $1 billion. This might be it. Might be it. So Pete,
Adam Webb
isn't gonna hit that. I only saw it once, so it had no shot. You know, I never seen it.
So Pete, you famously did not like the first film. You said it was boring.
Yeah.
You didn't like it.
Yeah.
So I'm interested to hear what you thought about the second one.
I think this one's better than the first one. I thought it was a well-made movie. Special effects are really cool. It made me think of a lot of other movies that I saw. I have some random weird thoughts about it. I just don't think like this type of movie is my thing.
Okay.
This like grand epic space operatic bullshit. Like I'm as a joke, like lightly I'm turning, like don't get offended. You know, like I'm just saying, like it's just whatever. You know, like Star Wars, Andrew mentioned Lord of the Rings. Like I don't like that either. Like, you know, like I was kind of like,
oh, I know.
You know, as much as I like BVS, I think that movie's too long too. You know, like I'm like a 2-hour movie guy. So like before you come at me and tell me how crazy I am. But like, I don't think this movie felt long at all. Like it didn't feel 3 hours. Yeah. In my opinion, 245 or whatever. I thought you guys hit a like well-paced movie. I'm just not into it. Fighting choreography was great. Austin Butler was incredible. I was actually rooting for him to kill fake Nico. I thought he was great in the final fight. But like, every time I saw these spaceships, I thought of Man of Steel and Krypton. And
fair.
You know, and then every time... Do you remember in Justice League, the Snyder Cut, where every time they showed Wonder Woman, they did the like Amazonian war cry?
Yes.
I had this, like, every time Zendaya or like fake Nico was on top of a dune, I just heard, la, la. So I'm like, I was like, I hope the same people who made fun of that are making fun of this, because it's the same thing. That was cool. And then I thought all the sand people actually reminded me of Dr. Doom from Josh Trank's Fantastic Four. The very end, like they all had like the same outfit, like they're it was weird, but I liked how they like popped out and fought and stuff. But those are like my three really random. Oh, and all the bald white people, like they reminded me of Mad Max. Okay. Like that's what I was thinking. I was like, oh, this stuff is like, and I was like, is this like Dune the inspiration for like everything? You know, let's say like it came before everything, like as a book. So I'm like, yeah, I could see Star Wars and I could see the influence from other directors and everything. So I'm like, I was trying to figure out, I was like, I can't call this a ripoff, because like technically, like these nerdy guys read these books and were like, oh, this is awesome. We're gonna take the, you know, like when they use the light to like shine the tunnel and walk through it. Yeah. I thought of Prometheus when they use like the radars to kind of like, you know, fly around the shit. Like I was like, there's like inspiration from the like last 40 years of sci-fi. And it's all been pulled from this book. That was cool for me to see that. Like I was like witnessing like the inspiration of history that, but decades later, but right. Yeah, like I don't know. The story is just kind of boring to me. I'm not all about this rebellious planet, which makes me wonder, like, would I just really not enjoy Rebel Moon either? Like, I feel like that's kind of like the same story, this like Star Wars epic, giant fight for peace or freedom or whatever. Like, I just don't think I'm into those type movies.
I couldn't tell you how Rebel Moon 1 ends because I didn't watch it through. I got about 45 minutes in and I couldn't watch the rest of it.
But like, you know, I'm an idiot. I like Madam Web. So like, I think I could at least sit through Rebel Moon. Like, you know, I've never walked out of a movie. Like, I'm going to watch it till the end because I'm curious. Like, I'm like, well, does it get worse? Does it get better? How does it end? You know, like, that's kind of where I'm like, I paid for this. I'm just sitting in the dark drinking soda. Like, am I really going to leave?
No, I don't ever leave movies, you know, either. I've been like, tempted a few times, but it's very rare that a movie's so bad I'm just going to walk out of it.
The curiosity gets me.
So.
But this, I wish somebody made a movie like Madam Web as good as this movie's made, because I could see the love and care, and it's beautifully shot, especially like Denny made this movie and he's so passionate about it. And I'm like, that's, you know, if you're a fan of Dune, you got to be really happy with this. And a lot of you seem to be, are, and that's got to be the best part. Cause it's like this, it's like one of you, you know, one of us. Like, it's just like, you know, I'm just sitting there like, oh, good. I hope I feel this way come Batman 2. That's it. Like, that's kind of where I'm at. You know, like, I'm all that, like, Reeves is my guy. If you're a Dune fan, Denny's your guy. And I like Denny too. Like, I love Blade Runner. I love Arrival. You know, like, these are the only, I'm just not into this Dune stuff.
No, I mean, that's fair. You didn't like the first one. So when you even told me you were even going to go see this one, I was surprised.
I do for the show. Like, I sit through these horrible TV shows. I sit through these amazing movies I don't like. I watched Endgame for this show. You know, the things I do for Holzman. but everyone's talking about it. How could you not see it? It is an event. Like, there were, I haven't been to, that's the most packed theater I've been to post COVID.
Yeah.
That's it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Most packed theater I've been to. Easily.
I think.
Interesting story, though. I got a side story about this. This is very funny. It involves the police. Mm-hmm. Right as fake Nico and MJ are getting it in, the movie pauses. So they're just face to face in this intimate moment in the movie, and it just stops. And everyone's kind of like, what's going on? All of a sudden, the lights pop up. These two movie attendants come around the corner, and she's like, the guy in the red shirt, the one in the ball cap, and the guy in the pink hoodie. And then out of nowhere, between, like, you know, like, there's the front of there's the theater and the hallway, four cops come around the corner, take these guys out, and then they just, lights go off when the movie starts.
Oh my God. And you don't know what they took them out for.
I don't know, because two of the guys end up coming back and watching the movie and one guy didn't. So I don't know what happened.
Oh my God.
Yeah, so I was like, did these guys just steal movies? I've never seen this. Like, was Dune so popular and was it so sold out that these guys stole movie tickets and then got arrested for stealing somebody's seat?
Wow.
Never saw that before. Never. So it was kind of funny. But like right in this like passionate moment, the movie just stops and it's just so weird.
The timing, right? Perfect timing. That's fantastic. I mean, I now I'm curious. I want to know what the hell they did that they got pulled out.
Yeah.
But
two of them came back. It was very interesting. I have no idea. I'm not nosy, so I didn't care. I just took the experience and rolled with it because I'm like, I can't wait to talk about this on the podcast.
That's fantastic. Wow.
Yeah.
Well, maybe they were, you know, they didn't like the Fremen or something, and they were just.
I have no idea because I'm like, what could you do wrong at a movie theater other than walk into a movie or not? So like, you can't steal popcorn or soda. Like, what could you steal? There's only one thing you get caught for: theater hopping.
I know that could. That's probably the only thing. And I didn't. I can't believe they would call the cops or something like that. But okay.
It was very strange. It was weird. Like, these two like a movie attendants walked around the theater. And they did like two laps, but like I just thought they were just doing their job. Like, yeah, you see them. They walk around with the airport flashlight
right.
or whatever. Like, I guess that's their that's why they do it. And they caught these people or somebody who was stealing a movie seat. I don't know. It was so funny.
Oh, man. That's crazy.
that's an interesting side story.
that is crazy. Well, I loved the first one and I loved this one even more. This is a movie in my wheelhouse. I'm a big science fiction guy. Star Wars was very influenced by Dune. You know, you can even see it in the stories of Paul and Anakin. They're very similar stories. I was anticipating after the first film, I was really anticipating this one, and it lived up to all the hype for me. I mean, this movie it's filmmaking at its best. Christopher Nolan should be happy that it got pushed back, because to me, this would beat Oppenheimer for Best Picture. I mean, Pete, you haven't seen Oppenheimer. Andrew, no, have you seen Oppenheimer?
I have seen Oppenheimer.
Okay. I picked this over Oppenheimer because of the action. Because you're talking about two long-ass movies that I probably don't really want to see to begin with. I would pick Dune over Oppenheimer. I haven't even seen Oppenheimer. Like, everyone just tells me Oppenheimer is just dialogue, you know, and it's just a lot of exposition and talking. So
yeah, I mean, I've said my feelings on it. I think Oppenheimer is very well made. I think it's a very good movie. I just think it's about 40 minutes too long. That's my opinion. I think there's a better movie there. But again, I just think this movie is so much, it's denser, and yet it doesn't have those points in the film where I was kind of like, okay, when is this ending? I didn't have that feeling. I had that when I saw Oppenheimer. So, but having said all that, just speaking strictly on Dune itself, Timothy Chalamet was a good actor before this, and now I think he's going to be seen as a great actor.
Yeah, he's intense, man.
Yeah, his performance in this movie was one of the best I've seen in a long time, and he carries the film in some points. I mean, the cast overall is great. Javier Bardem is fantastic. Like, he's great. He's
really good.
I don't think there's one bad acting job in this entire movie.
Exactly. It's really hard to pick. And that's the thing. Thinking about the film, it's really hard for me to pick something that I didn't like. Right. And there's usually movies, like, I can pick at least one or two things where I thought was off. I can't say that about this movie.
I've heard you complain about BVS.
Yeah, a little bit.
One or two things.
Yeah, so, I mean, this movie hit all the hype I was worried about. That's why I muted everything on Twitter going in. I'm like, I don't want to hear about this film too much.
When did you see it?
I saw it Thursday afternoon.
Andrew, what about you? When did you see it?
I saw it today because you were going to see it, so I had time to go see it myself. So
my man, pots and pans.
Today.
Yeah, so I saw it in IMAX. I actually took the half a day at work to go watch it because I wanted to see it before everyone else did. And I really got
a little disappointed. There's no car review. You realize, like, I think Andrew will agree with me. The car review is a big part of Stranded in Gotham. When we don't get one, you know, and I love the little orangeade one you did the other day. I just wanted to squeeze you like some, Florida grape.
Sweatshirt on. Yeah. My orange sweatshirt. Yes. I was wearing it.
I didn't know that Eric had watched this movie because there wasn't a car review, I didn't know. So,
I had no way of knowing. I was like, dude, people talk to me when you do them.
Well, the reason I didn't do a car review is because I saw it in Manhattan and I didn't drive to go there. So there was no, I guess I could have done it on the train. That would have been a kind of a twist.
We could have done the subway, right? The subway, the LIR.
That's true. I could have done it on the train.
Do they still sell beer on the LIR?
They don't. No.
COVID ruined it.
No.
Long Island Railroad was the greatest railroad in the history of railroads.
No more beer. I know.
If you don't know what I'm talking about, Roses is open, by the way. Roses reopened.
Yeah, I was in Penn the other day and I saw it. Yeah.
I'm very excited. Yeah. Sorry, Andrew. We're a little Penn Station side tangent.
Yeah. The New York part's coming out right now, so we apologize for that. But this movie is, to me, it lived up to the hype, and there's been kind of speculation about if a third one was going to be done, and I think they're just waiting to see. Yeah, I think they're just waiting to see how good this one's going to do. I don't think that's a problem anymore.
Dude, I'm at the point with Dune, like, it's everyone loves this thing so much where I honestly, and it's going to make a ton of money. It's not if they're going to make a third one. It's like, are they just going to be that confident in Fast Track 4? Like, could he do a back to back? Like, I don't know. Like, because recently he said they did an interview pre this movie with Vin Denny. I forgot who it was. But he said he would never do somebody else's franchise again, like he did Blade Runner, because he's just so paranoid about it. Like, he never lived up to it, even though like Ridley Scott was like, no, I approve, do this, go ahead. I wonder if he's like just so like anti against doing something else where he just focuses on this and makes this his thing.
Yeah. I mean, it is his now. So,
yeah,
I think he said that he only wanted to do three.
Mm-hmm.
I think maybe in that same interview. So. Mm-hmm. And I also remember after the first one came out that the second one was announced like a week later.
Yeah.
Like they're like, we're doing this. And so I wouldn't be surprised if the same thing happens. Like opening. I mean, weekend,
they did announce Wonder Woman 3 after 84 too.
Well, as we said before, I think that was to pump the numbers of 84, but we all see how that worked out.
Same studio. So I'm nervous. Yeah, it's all Wonder
Woman. You're right. It is the same studio. But I wouldn't be surprised if, you know, I think I heard it from Hans Zimmer because I follow him on Facebook or something. He's like, yeah, Dune 2 is happening. And so I wouldn't be surprised if I hear that same thing next week.
I think it's
going to be very successful at the box
office. So you bring up Zimmer. He's done a lot of scores of movies that we've all seen and enjoyed. What do you think of the score for this?
So I liked it. It wasn't bad in any way, but I was surprised at how there were so many scenes that were just silent, which was cool. Yeah. I liked it. But I was also like, man, dude's getting a bag for just redoing everything he did in the first movie, which fine for him. Like that's that is what it is. He's made enough music. But I would have liked to hear more. Again, kind of the sequel thing. I feel like he has already stated that he's started writing for a third movie. Like dude's just writing away. So I imagine that we'll get a lot more in the third one, which will be cool. So I didn't hate it, but I was for a three hour movie, 2 hour 45 minute movie, it would have been nice to hear more, in my opinion.
Yeah.
I don't think I remember much of the score at all outside of the war cry part of the song. Like I to be really honest. Like I don't think it stands out at all. Like I'm kind of it's almost just kind of forgettable.
Yeah, it's much more subtle in this one. I thought it was much more prominent in the first one. The music does seem a little more subtle, even when there is music. But I think it was important because this movie does have a lot of material you have to get through. And sometimes the score can be a distraction. So I think it was important in this movie to just focus on the actual story beats. So, I mean, I mentioned Star Wars, that this is a very similar story to Anakin. And I'll leave this open for either of you. Are there any other stories you can think of that are similar to Dune, whether it's sci-fi or not? Is there anything else you can think about? Because I have another one in my head. I just want to see if you guys go there with me.
I can't think of anything right now, to be honest with you.
Okay.
I mean, it's the trope of playing both sides, right? He's from the House of Atreides, like the organized world, and then he is now part of this native culture. So first thing I think of, for better or for worse, is Avatar 1 is basically the same plot, right? He was part of the invading species,
sure,
and then he joined the opposite species to fight for them, and there's a native aspect.
Okay, I didn't like that one either. There's a theme here.
But there's also Chosen One elements, right. And that's more the Star Wars aspect. But the Chosen One makes me think of the Matrix.
Yep,
there's
that's
a lot
one
of
I had in my head too.
But those would be the two.
Two. The Godfather is the one I thought of.
Yeah, why do you think that?
Because in the first film, Michael starts out as a war hero, doesn't want to be in the family business,
I get what you're going with it.
And then he winds up turning to be even more ruthless than his father ever was. Mm. And that's something that Paul goes through. He starts out like good intentions, hero. He's, you know, becoming a hero. And then he finds out the truth and he just turns and he becomes more of a tyrant than an actual savior. So to me, the Godfather was another, Michael Corleone was another character I thought of when I thought of this. And I mean, it's a pull. I didn't see it until recently. Cause after I saw it, I was watching the Godfather yesterday and that's when it hit me. I was like, oh wow, this is a very similar story to the story of Paul Atreides.
Not bad.
So yeah, I mean, I didn't read the Dune novels. I kind of wish I did because I'm sure there's a little bit more richness. I know there's differences in the characterizations and some people, some of the characters are portrayed a little bit differently in the book as we got in the film. But I kind of want to go back and read them now. Do either of you, Pete, I'm sure you don't, but Andrew, do you have any desire to go back and read?
No, I'm not interested at all.
Did we lose him?
Yeah, I do have a... It would be nice to know, similar to Lord of the Rings. It's like, oh, this is cool. Let's go back and also, you know, see what's going on there.
Yeah.
I wish it was that easy to get Eric to read some comics in Batman.
I'm much better with novels and prose, and I'm much better reading those.
Prose.
Kinds of
Paul
things.
Herman would not like that.
I just am. I don't know why. It's just, I think it's because of the finality of it. Most books have an ending.
Mm-hmm.
Comic books never end. Like, but you just keep going and going.
You love
and going.
The MCU. You love it. It's continuous. It's connected. You love it.
I don't, though, as much as I did. Like, I'll admit
he's
that
earned.
It's even...
He's earned.
It's even... Yeah, it's even getting a little bit played for me.
Oh, wow.
I'll still watch it because I enjoy the characters more than anything else. But...
Is this because Captain Marvel's kind of, like, on the outs right now? Like,
we're going to get to that, but no, I'm not... It has nothing to do with Carol Danvers and Captain Marvel and Brie Larson. It has nothing to do with any of them.
Well, if you say so.
Yeah. So, what didn't you like about Dune 2, Andrew? If anything.
I can't really think of anything right now. I'll probably think of stuff over the week, but. The length, I think, could be a deterrent for some people. I think kind of what Pete speaks on, like with Lord of the Rings, and this, I think, falls under the similar category. Even though both of those movies, I think, do a good job of holding, this is going to sound condescending, but I don't mean it that way. They do a good job of holding the general audience's hand that they can follow and enjoy the story, as well as, you know, quote unquote, giving the fans what they want. In that story, so I like, there's a lot of lore stuff that goes into both of those movies that I really enjoy, and I think a lot of people enjoy from those books and those movies. But again, even though you can follow the plot, there's still a lot of lore stuff that I feel might also be a turnoff for some people, because there's a lot of, I mean, there's this whole language, there's all these planets, there's all these factions, and it's like. Yeah, you could follow along and enjoy it, but it might also deter you from going back because it's so thick of a world, just like Lord of the Rings, in my opinion. So I don't dislike that about it, but I'm just wondering what other people think with that thick of a.
Yeah, there have been material. some traditionalists, I guess, or some people who are loyal to the books who have had complaints about some of the things that they liberties he took and things he might have changed.
Sound like Star Wars fans.
Oh, no. They maybe eventually we might get there depending on how many Dune stories they wind up telling. Well, but they're starting. There's nothing like Star Wars fans. Nothing. They are they're a special group all in and of themselves.
Yes, you are.
So, Pete, you didn't really, outside of it's not your thing, you didn't really say much about the content that you didn't like. What is there anything in the movie
that I specifically hated?
Yeah.
No, I think it's a well-made movie. I get why people like it. I'm just not interested in this story. I didn't get it. I just. The twist at the end when he was in the Harkness, Harkonnen, whatever his name is, you know, the fat bald guy, when he turned out like he was his grandson, like it didn't like kind of throw me off at all, really. I thought it was predictable when they showed the blade in fake Nico and then Austin Butler went to stab him, but he actually, I was like, oh, he's going to pull the blade out of him and stab him while he's blocking. I was like, I've played Mortal Kombat enough. I know that move. You know? So like, I thought that was the most predictable. But outside of that, it's still a very well-made movie. My favorite part of the movie is every time Austin Butler's on the scene. Like, he's killing people and feeding them to his vampire whores, like whatever. I thought that was great. Like when he's sitting there like threatening his fat uncle in the hot tub, I thought that was cool. The fight scene was cool. Austin Butler just kicks ass, and I'm like, I really guess I have to see this Elvis movie now. Bill's been ragging on me. He's like, you gotta see this Gumbo, let's go. And I haven't seen it yet. So I guess I'm gonna have to, because he's really incredible here. Did he shave his eyebrows for this? Did they all shave their eyebrows? I'm very interested to find that out. Yeah.
I don't know.
Because the last time an actor did that, I feel like it was Leto for Joker.
he might have. I don't know. It's such a stark difference from Elvis. Like, honestly, it is such a different portrayal. Like, and
his head looks so weird.
It was cool to see him play this part because he had gotten gotten kind of ridiculed for carrying the Elvis accent for a while after the film. And
right.
He would do interviews and stuff and people like, you still sound like Elvis. And so it was cool to see him play a completely different part and kill it. I mean, he was great.
He was nuts.
Yeah. He was fantastic. He really kind of gave that, I mean, villain, right? Like we always say, who's the villain? Mm-hmm. And he really had a great presence as the villain in this film.
I'll also say this. I felt bad for Zendaya when he was like, I'm gonna take her hand and you spare your. I was like, dude, you just told this chick you loved her forever, and you're like, I'm gonna take this broad.
Oh yeah.
Like, it's like, that's a dick move.
Well,
I did feel bad for her.
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah, there's more to the story. So, and that's the thing. Like, that's what happens. If he tells the third one, you'll see what happens with that part of the story. But
and at the same time, I was like, I get it though. Cause I was like, Nico loves Pew. Fake Nico is going to marry Pew in this movie. This is destiny. Every time I couldn't help but think of Nico when I saw this guy, I just couldn't help it. The whole movie. I mean, I, like, Nico's just kicking ass. I was like, Nico's the chosen one. He's the TikTok film god.
I thought it was weird that she spoke in an American accent because she's English.
Really?
And I thought it was weird that she spoke in an American accent because, and I know they probably did it because Christopher Walken obviously is an American and there's no way around it. So, but I thought it was weird that they had her do that because everyone else spoke kind of in their just normal speaking voice. But she was the one who had to speak in an American accent. And I guess, like I said, it's because Christopher Walken's her father and he didn't want to have that difference there. But
I also forgot about the crazy voice throughout the entire movie until it came. Like, I forgot it was there until they used it. There was only a few instances. Like, I remember the first one when they started using it, like I think they were like drinking tea or something at a long table, like in 89, you know, like past the salt. And, like, they were doing that. That's the first, I remember it then. And then when it popped up here, I was like, oh, that's a thing. I forgot about
that. Yeah. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. And obviously that's like the Force, right? Like, you can see the Star Wars relation there. Like, something similar,
okay,
you know, similar to the Force and the build having those kinds of special abilities.
What's it called in the Duneverse?
I don't remember. I'm terrible.
No, it's fine. I mean, I'm curious. I mean, you know, I was just like, whoa, but, I forgot about that. Like, holy. Yeah.
So yeah, there's, again, this movie is so layered, so deep, such a well done movie. Yeah, I really hope that Messiah, he does do Messiah, and that we get the final film in this story.
I mean, there an end to Dune, like the novel wise? Like, does it have, like, I know there's a lot of them, but like, I think, does it have like an ending, or is it just ongoing?
I think there's six books.
There's okay. There's two different types because there's one actual written, there's a few more actually written by Frank Herbert, and then
I don't know if it was
an error or something continued the story. So I think if you look up the full book like pantheon, it's like 15 books or something like that.
Whoa.
But then it's like, do people just take the first two because that's kind of like the bulk of the story, and then the rest is other stuff, or do you take everything that Frank Herbert wrote? Like, it's there's a lot there if you wanted to do stuff, but to do it at this level, I think that would be a lot. I don't think they would do that.
Oh, there's a
lot. They could have this whole Duneverse if they wanted to. They should do that instead of forcing this DCU down our throats. People are actually going to go see these movies. I'm sorry, that's just true.
Okay, so I was right. There are six original stories that Herbert wrote, and then his son picked it up and started writing more. Into the 2000s. Yeah. So, there's more that, but the of his work, it's six. Just the six books.
And he's adapted how many books already out of these two movies?
Just one.
Oh, wow. Okay.
It's just so the first one.
So we're getting 12 movies.
It's just the first. I don't know. I mean, it's possible. I don't know, but this Doom is just the first book.
Blow the MCU away. So. Watch.
I don't know. I mean, I don't think he wants that kind of commitment.
Don't think it's going to happen. I feel like that was a monster in itself.
So, but Pete, you've brought up 89 a couple times.
Yeah.
And I know you went and saw last night the orchestra
version. Yeah, I saw it at the New Jersey Performing Arts Center with the New Jersey Symphony Orchestra. Uh-huh. It was the 35th anniversary live concert and movie. And it's just, what an experience just to see that movie again. And it's a different version of the movie, and it's cool to see it with the live orchestra. And there's certain times, like in certain scenes, where I heard dialogue and lines that I didn't know was in the movie. And I was like, you mentioned how, like, I know the Batman so well, but like I've known 89 even more. Like, I was like,
yeah, right.
Certain parts, cause they had the subtitles on the film. Like, he's like, that's cop talks in the scene. Like, I was like, he speaks, like, it's so weird. It was very interesting. It was overall, it was just a fantastic time. A bunch of people were there, met some people from the BOF group, a bunch of my friends. It was just fun time, and man, just it was a blast. It was really good to see a bunch of people dressed up as Joker, and just to see how that movie, just still 35 years later, can just fill an entire, you know, venue of people to see it after all this time just speaks volumes. Like, it's Batman 8, plot holes and all. Like, Batman 89 is just a triumph. To quote Mark Hughes.
Do you recommend seeing it this way?
I would recommend anybody seeing any movie this way. This is the second movie I've seen this way, and it's a cool experience to see it. Like, the only time I've ever done this, actually, for believe it or not, is actually see Mary Poppins. And that's cool because that's a musical anyway. And to do that with a live orchestra was awesome. I saw it at the State Theater in New Brunswick, New Jersey. So if you can do anything like this, definitely. I mean, I know at the NJ PAC, they're doing Empire Strikes Back soon, wow. Eric. So if you're interested, if somebody like you take the train in, it's not that bad. It's actually walking distance. It's basically, if you've ever walked to Prudential Center from Newark Penn Station, instead of making the left to go to the arena, you make a right to go to the art center, and it's same distance, just opposite direction.
Okay.
So, I mean, it's commuter friendly. Anybody could see any movie. I would totally do it. This was so much fun. It was a blast. It really was.
That's awesome. All right. Yeah. I have to look into that. I know they did it for Lord of the Rings too. That must have been really long.
Yeah, but I think they do it all. I think that's just the thing they do. I think the orchestra either rents it out or whatever. They just have them have events there. So definitely, if you're in the Metro New York Tri-State area, sometimes it's cool to do the reverse commute coming to Jersey.
All right, maybe I will. I mean, they might even have it out coming out here. I don't know.
I know for 89 they did a tour. They're doing a tour, I think. Like, it's going other places. Like, I don't know if it's the same orchestra or what, or they just take the movie or whatever. But I know there's, like, it's going other places. Like, somebody saw it earlier. They were sending me pictures or something from their venue. So, like, it's kind of like a tour thing.
All right. That's cool, though. I mean,
yeah,
I think it's awesome you got to go see that.
Yeah, no, it was great. I had so much fun. It was like, you know, watching it almost for like the first time.
Right? That's cool.
And awesome stuff. Movie with that. It was interesting too, because like that movie, such a great soundtrack. Not only Danny Elfman but Prince as well. And it was interesting to see, like, you know, there's so many major Prince moments. Like, the orchestra does nothing because it's Prince. Like, they're just playing the score. But it was fun to see them trade off at times. Like, I was like, I wonder if Danny Elfman felt like this. Like, damn it, he's stealing my moment.
Well, I'm glad you got to see that, and I'll definitely try and check it out if I get a chance. I think that'd be fun.
Yeah.
Fun thing to do. All right, so outside of Dune 2 coming out this week, I think the second bit of news we all got was on Superman's birthday, James Gunn gave us a glimpse of the crest and the title on Instagram. And the title is just going to be Superman, it's not Superman Legacy. That was, you know, to kind of hold our interest.
Title.
Yeah. And then now he just decided to call it Superman. So very, I thought that was very cool. I thought it was very smart to announce it on that day. Andrew, I kind of know Pete's feelings on Superman and where they're going with this. What are your feelings on, first of all, what he did on with that, and then on expectations for this film?
Yeah, I think like many other people, were expecting something on that day. And as the day went on, I'm like, oh no, he's not going to do anything. Like, it's going to go unannounced. But he did do it. I was happy about it. I was happy it was just the crest. It was a small enough tease, but I think it made enough people excited. I guess I like the name change. I think it makes more sense. The more I thought about it, I was like, does Superman Legacy sound like a documentary to the general audience? Would that be like, we're going to see the Superman documentary, Superman Legacy? So I don't know if that had anything to do with it, but I think it was smart. Superman 2025. So yeah, I liked it. I was waiting for it. I liked it. I'm glad he did something. And then, yeah, overall thoughts, I'm not as cautious as maybe Pete might be, but I am adopting more caution as we actually get closer. I'm excited they're starting with a Superman movie. I think that makes sense. I thought it made sense the first time that they did it, and we see how that worked out. So I think it'll be good. I like James Gunn. I like what he did with the Guardians movies. I think it will be good. Will the general audience accept it? No clue. So I'm excited a Superman movie's being made as the short version. Will it take the world by storm like maybe it might need to for WB to keep doing this thing? We'll see. We have about a year and a half.
Does including all the other characters, does that bother you?
It doesn't actually bother me as a fan. I know a bunch of people, really, you guys have talked about how he's only doing that to set up the rest of the universe, which in general I agree with. I think Bill at one point said he has to be doing it for the rest of the universe, because if there wasn't the rest of the universe, he wouldn't have added these characters. Right. And I think that logic makes sense, but I think he's a smart enough writer that even with these characters in there, that it will, like, he'll make a solid enough Superman story that just happens to have these other characters in here. Like, I trust him enough to do that. Again, whether that's true or not, we'll see. So it as a fan, I'm excited about it. It might, like, if we think BVS was overstuffed, as some people say, you know, this is not, that doesn't bode well for this movie.
No one can see you point, Eric. It's radio.
He could see me because we're in video, so he could see me. But yeah, I mean, I thought BVS was a little overstuffed. But all right, so Pete, does the name change just to Superman? Does that calm your fears, or does it have no impact on?
The name change to Superman does nothing for me, but the casting of Perry White does.
Yeah.
So like, right. If I'm going to be, that's it. I'm being consistent. Day one, I thought there was a lack of Superman characters in the movie, and at least they are trickling in. I hope Perry White has a bigger influence in the movie than Green Lantern. If you don't agree with me, I'm sorry. That's just my opinion. and I don't think you can call me crazy for that. We'll see what happens. I don't know what he's going to do. I don't know what his plan is, and what are these other characters, just cameos, but I'm happy that Perry White is cast. I don't know anything about the gentleman. I don't think I've ever seen any of his work. So, everyone says it's great. I'm going to trust everyone on this. Good for it. I trust James Gunn. He's cast the guy he wants. I know, everyone seems to be excited. Pictures, everyone's doing TikToks and stuff. I find it interesting that our new Superman is always wearing a ski cap. We can't see his hair. I'm interested. Like, is he wearing a wig? Is that why they won't do it? Just kind of, I mean, it's Hollywood. So like, you know, it's not real. It's fake. So he can wear fake hair. Affleck wears fake hair. So like, it's like a thing. I'm curious. You know, these are things I'm interested in. I'm like, oh my God, I can see Lex's bald head, but Superman looks like he's going skiing. But yeah, I don't know. Like, we'll see. I'm still kind of just optimistically cautious, hesitant, nervous, scared. That's kind of where I'm at.
Okay.
You know?
All right. Yeah, I mean, I thought the name change was smart because of that, for that reason alone. I think Superman Legacy left a lot open to interpretation.
It did sound weird.
Right. But if you're just calling it Superman now, I think that's more of a focus. And I think he did it on purpose, because I think he's worried, too, that people saw all these other castings with all these other characters, and he's like, they're not thinking this is going to be a Superman film.
Sure.
And he just wants to say, no, this is a Superman film, so I'm going to call it that. And, you know, that's what I want people to think. It's just a Superman movie, and these other characters will be in it, but we're not, you know, you'll see how they play out when the movie finally comes out. Sorry. But the actor he chose to play Perry White is Wendell Pierce. And he, you may not think you know him, Pete, but I would bet any amount of money you've seen him in something. He's popped
up somewhere. Yeah.
Yes. Sure. That you've seen him in something. He's been in a lot of different things. He's been in TV and film. He's been in both. Right now he's on Power. I think he's on the Power show that's on Stars, the 50 Cent produced vehicle. I think he's on that. He used to be on Suits. If you ever watched the show Suits, he was on that. He's well known. And when I saw this, I was like, wow,
this everyone is awesome. Said this. Everyone is raving about it. So I'm just like, okay, like, this is good. You know, but first of all, like, you know, I'm not going to tell him he cast the wrong person. Like, I got to see it, you know, like, you know, so whatever. And I say that about all of them. So,
yeah, I mean, if you liked Fishburne, I think you're going to like him. Mm-hmm. That's how I'll say it. I think
there's not a Perry White I've seen in live action that I've disliked, you know, from what I've got. The weakest one's probably Superman Returns. That's probably the weakest one I could think of.
Yeah.
You know, what's his name in the Donner movies is fantastic.
He is.
I had no problem with Lawrence and his pierced ear. I thought that was cool to give Perry some bling. Like, I dug that. Especially in Man of Steel, I dug Perry White. You know, I'm a big Fishburne guy. I don't know, but it's that voice.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. It's that voice. You
know, it's that voice. It's
not Andrew, are you familiar? Yeah, I know. Are you familiar with Wendell Pierce's work?
I'm not. I saw some of Suits. I don't know if I watched it enough to see him because I don't remember explicit storylines with him. My wife watched Jack Ryan, which, you know, she's like, oh, yeah, he was in that and he was good. So, so I am assuming as well that I've seen something with him in it, but I couldn't place. He looked familiar.
The Wire as well. He was in The Wire. If you ever
then I've definitely seen him in something.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm excited. I think I did think of you, Peter, right away, because I was like, oh, he's been waiting for a Perry White.
It's been one of the characters specifically. Like, I don't know. Yeah. Daily Planet Newsroom is a big part of Superman for me.
Right. Yeah. I think the thing that makes me nervous about the casting, because you said, you know, he better be more important than Green Lantern, is that James Gunn at some point said everybody that has a key role will be at the table read that happened earlier. And I think this casting happened after that.
That's a valid point. That makes me think that
Perry White had a smaller role because Green Lantern was at the table reading, and apparently he didn't care enough to cast Perry White before the table reading. So take that for what you will.
Okay. Well, thanks for making me feel nervous.
Yeah.
It could have just been a scheduling thing, though. Yeah. And, you know, he might have had
He's took him like 7 months to get you here.
So seriously, man. It's not as easy as it seems. everything works together. So, but yeah, I mean, I'm happier now that we have a title. And I know we're going to start getting dribs and drabs of things. I don't want to see any, obviously, set photos or nothing. I don't want to see it.
No set photos, Kowalski.
But I definitely know we're going to start getting little leaks of the plot, I'm sure. So
I'd like to know what the plot is. Like, I'd like to know the premise of the movie. Like, has that been addressed? I try to stay spoiler free. So I'm not, there's certain circles I don't travel in on the internet because I get nervous that I'm going to see something I don't want to see. And for Superman, I don't want to see anything, to be honest with you, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know essentially like what he's really kind of doing here. I just, you know, I'd like some sort of premise.
Yes. So let's stick with the Superman thing, because this story that you sent me, Pete, was interesting. I didn't even know this was possibly a thing. So apparently when Superman Returns came out, there was talk there was going to be some kind of a spinoff with Brandon Routh's character. TV, mm-hmm. and he was at, and Mark Guggenheim, who created and, you know, produced the Arrowverse and all of that, was asked about it. And the follower asked if he had any promotional photos of Brandon Routh as Superman from the Crisis on Infinite Earth, on Infinite Earth's event that ran. And then he said that got misinterpreted. He said, think nothing of it. I posted what I had on my Dropbox and casually mentioned, because I thought it was a fun little nugget, that Brandon and I had talked about some kind of sequel series for his version of Superman. Well, that little comment went viral. A friend of mine, a comic shop owner, texted me that suddenly his Facebook feed was nothing but articles about the comment, some of which exaggerated said comment into a possibility, there is none that I can reasonably conceive of, or even talks, which haven't happened unless you count Brandon in my little chats. I share because it's an amusing anecdote that demonstrates how even the most innocuous of comments can occasionally go viral, and a great example of how much love there is still for the Arrowverse. Now, I love a lot of the Arrowverse, obviously not all of it, because there's shows in it that you like that I didn't.
Yeah, Supergirl.
But
female superheroes, Eric.
Do you guys think that would have been a good show? I mean, obviously it would have been years before the Arrowverse began. Do you think it would have been cool to have a spinoff TV show from Superman Returns?
I like Superman Returns, so I would have been down for it. I'm one of the few people who actually enjoy that movie. So I would, and then seeing Brandon Routh pop up on Crisis on Infinite Earth was great again, and seeing that S.H.I.E.L.D. for the first time in that Kingdom Come style was great, and we'll get that again with the James Gunn stuff too, which is nice.
Yeah,
I would have been down for it. Like, I get it though, but it's cool to know that Superman on TV is kind of always in the works. It seems like, right? Like, he's been very successful on TV. Superman and Lois has been great. I know it's ending because of James Gunn, but I think it's been really good for three seasons, and I enjoyed his various cameos throughout the Arrowverse shows, especially in Supergirl and stuff. So, yeah, it would have been cool, but it's, you know, I feel like with a lot of these topics, it's always like kind of like the what ifs.
Andrew, do you like Routh's Superman?
I remember watching that movie when it came out, and I was like, okay, cool, another Superman movie. It didn't blow up for me. I was like, it's cool to see Superman again. I actually read the article differently. I thought there's going to be a spinoff show, like a current spinoff show with an older Brandon Routh, rather than a spinoff show from
I took it too. Like, it was post Crisis, like,
yeah, post Crisis.
They were going to either do. Like, maybe it was like Superman and Lois or this, and they pick Superman and Lois. That's kind of what I was thinking.
That's how I read it. Which reading it that way, I was like, that was never going to happen. Like, I don't know why people took and ran with it. Like, I understand misinterpreting the comments, but I was like, with everything happening right now, you think that they're going to do that? I don't know.
It would have been cool if they did it. Like, I
But see, I think it said the 2006, it mentioned it in there. And I just, when I read the rest of it, I just said, okay, they wanted to do that.
They tricked you.
Well, yeah, but actually it probably would have worked better back then than it would now.
It's possible.
So So yeah, it would have been a, well, I did like his portrayal of Superman. He didn't have much to say in the movie. Whatever.
I feel like that's a trend.
Right. They don't like Superman talking. It's a problem. But yeah, he didn't have much to say in that movie, but I thought his presence was fantastic, and it would have been cool, I think, to keep that story ongoing. You know, if they weren't going to do it in film, it would have been cool to see that in a TV show. Because like you said, he's for some reason, he works better on the small screen.
Imagine like Ralph's Superman standing next to Holzman's Aquaman. Like imagine that on the CW.
Imagine him standing next to Richton's Aquaman.
No, that's not my Aquaman.
Oh boy. All right, so we're going to talk about this Captain Marvel thing that Pete brought up. So apparently Brie Larson was at the SAG Awards last week, and they asked her specifically on Extra, the show Extra, if you watch it, if she was done playing or if she's going to continue playing Captain Marvel. She said, I don't have anything to say about that. So they went on to ask her more questions. Obviously, the movie, the Marvels didn't do that well, so it wouldn't be that surprising if she wasn't.
I still haven't seen it, actually.
I actually thought it was better than people are giving it credit for. But
did you like it better than the first?
I did because I like Ms. Marvel. I like the character. She's fantastic. She's great. Girl is fantastic. So
yeah,
I did enjoy that. And she's in it. She has a very big part in it. So it was very, very cool to see. So they asked her a little in November when the Marvels came out, they were asking her about it. And she said, there's still so much to explore. And she said, I feel like getting to be on this team just cracked her open in a way that she hadn't been. And I really loved her for that. So, I mean, I think she was better in this film than she was in the first film, even though I liked the first film. I just think the character had developed. And by the time we see her in the Marvels, she's more of a human being, because I felt like she was very much an alien in the first one, kind of trying to find her way.
Getting deep.
This one. Yeah. And this one, she's fully formed and becoming. So I'll just throw this out there. Andrew, I know how Pete feels. Do you like the character, number one, and did you like her portrayal, and would you like to see her continue?
I enjoyed the first one. I thought it was a fine origin movie, because we know how to do those now. We're very good at those.
Right.
I don't mind the character. I was excited how powerful she was, but then you start to get a power scaling problem in the MCU. It's like, okay, well, if she can come in and clean everything up, like, how is this fun anymore? But I enjoyed it. I didn't see the Marvels yet. My son was actually born 2 months earlier, so I was like, well, I'm not going to get to go to the movies.
So he saved you.
Yeah, thank you.
You owe him.
Just drop that little nugget. But I didn't get to go see it. Now that it's on Disney Plus, I still haven't seen it. You know, so take that excitement level for what you will. I would be excited to see her continue. I think more of this stuff is cool. I think Brie as an actor, though, has just gotten a huge smattering of misogyny. And I think she's like, all right, I'm out. Like, I don't have to deal with this. Like, she just seems to be on the forefront of you know, being attacked for, as the MCU. She's like the poster child for what people want to attack in these movies.
It's funny, like, I just, that's not one of my gripes. Just interesting that people take that side.
Yeah, it's like there can be things to complain about, sure, but that's just not one of them. So yeah, I agree. It's weird, but I think because there was an interview she did like a year ago where someone asked like, are we going to see more Captain Marvel? And she's like, I don't know. Apparently, people don't want to see her. Like, she was like, and the interviewer is like, whoa, don't say that. Like, she was like very candid about it. Like, she was over it already before this came out. So I think she is. I think she's tired of the fans for justifiable reasons. So if she doesn't come back, I wouldn't be surprised, especially after the performance of this movie.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm all for less Captain Marvel, but I think characters like Captain Marvel just need to not have movies made about them. I don't think they're big enough. I think that's part of the you've got to desaturate the genre. I think Captain Marvel is part of the problem. Like, it's just, it's too much, you know, like you're just giving people too many it's now they're just kind of like, oh, whatever, you know, like it's not special. You've gone to the well too often. And that's just my feeling. Like, again, it's not really about the character. It's not necessarily her. It has nothing to do with Brie Larson. I just don't think Captain Marvel is a character that needs a movie, in my opinion, to be brutally honest.
I just think overall, when I hear these stories and people ask these questions of these actors now who have been in the MCU, I just think that we're in a really weird place. They're in a really, really weird place now, because it's the first time they've ever really been questioned going forward.
It's fascinating,
right? And it is a fascinating dynamic when you think of where they were.
And Deadpool's the next movie to come out for them. Like, it's right, even like, it's so
it is. It's a really interesting place to be in right now, for them in a couple of ways. Like, I feel like there's a lot riding on Deadpool and Wolverine. Mm-hmm. And it does seem like obviously they're dipping into the TVA. From Loki, and that's going to be a big part of this movie. So there's a lot you could do there, right? There's a lot you can do with that. And we know how Deadpool, the character of Deadpool, and what he's been in the first two films, we kind of know that already.
You bringing up the TVA, I think, is interesting, because at one point, I think we said when we talked about Loki, is like, Loki, you don't really need to watch it to see everything else. Like, it kind of stands on its own. Now you're kind of like, oh no, we lied. We're wrong. You need to see Loki, because all of a sudden these guys with these wands just pop up. Like, what if you didn't see Loki or two seasons of Loki? You have no idea who the hell these guys are. Like, yeah. They're gonna have to explain it in the movie.
Yeah, I think they're going to. Just because it's a Deadpool. It's Deadpool, and mm-hmm. like I feel like Ryan Reynolds or Wade is going to explain who they are mm-hmm. in only a way that he can. Right. So I think we're gonna. See where there goes. But as far as like you said, it's too saturated, and you know, I think she has a place in the MCU, but I think you're right. I don't think there should be movies made anymore mm-hmm. about her. Like, you can bring her into Avengers if you want to. You can,
yeah, I'm down with that.
Bring the character into certain the other films, but
if you want to talk about like someone like Deadpool, like at one point I probably would have said the same thing about Deadpool, but I feel like Deadpool has already had two successful movies, and it's like everyone loves Ryan Reynolds. We're like, I know Captain Marvel was kind of successful, but like fans don't like it, but it made money and critics loved it, but no one liked Brie Larson, and it seems no one likes the sequel. It's like, it's a weird combination, you know, like it just is. It didn't work.
Yeah.
She pops up in Avengers and everyone hates that too. It's like, maybe people don't like her portrayal really. I don't know.
That I think is a big part of it. Yeah.
And the MCU doesn't really miss when it comes to casting, right? Like, for the most part.
I mean, I don't think they missed with her. I just think for reasons Andrew brought up before, and there's
the Kong movie she's in, right? She did that Kong movie with Loki. That was cool.
I think sometimes her personal stance on things seeps into the films. And
I wish people would stop worrying about that crap.
I know, but they don't. So, I mean, we saw it with Star Wars, and again, you're seeing it here. So I just think sometimes that happens, for better or worse. And in this instance, it's worse. I don't know. We'll see what happens with the character. I don't think she's going to disappear, but will Brie Larson play her again? I don't know. I can't tell you that. All right. So speaking of bad movies, I'm sorry. Venom and Venom 2 were not good movies, even though the first one made money. But Venom 3 is almost ready to wrap filming. Juno Temple, who's in Venom 3, recently spoke about it, and she said that they're almost done filming, and it's crazy. It's been a wonderful ride and all this other stuff. I can't believe we're still talking about this movie, to be honest, and this character, because
I can't wait to see this, because I think it's going to be like
Madam Web.
Is it gonna be like Madam Web? Like, I'm curious. Like, how? Like, I'm like, let's see what happens here. You know, like, you're on your third director for your third movie. There's a whole lot of consistency there. I'm very interested. Like, yeah. Like, and then what, does Craven come out before this? right?
I think so. Craven was supposed to come out this year.
Yeah, we got to get through that. So I'm wondering what that is even like. So Sony in their the SSU, very interested to see. They're just car wrecks on the highway at this point. I'm watching them as I drive by.
Are you a fan of the Venom movies, Andrew?
I was excited for the first one, as I think many people were, and that's why I made money. And I watched it, and I was like, okay. I think Beat, you have a really good take of, like, it feels like an early 2000s comic book movie, and we've essentially moved past that in a lot of ways. So it's like, well, I didn't know we were still making these.
They're hoping for nostalgia vibes, I guess.
Sure, I guess. Well, yeah, they're also hoping to reset the clock on these characters so that they can keep the rights to them. And the second one was fine. I didn't hate it, but it also didn't, like, it was pretty out there. Plot wise, it was like, what is happening in this movie? Morbius was all sorts of bad. That was a walk out of the theater.
I'm taking, like, Madam Web over Morbius anyway.
Unfortunately, I haven't seen that yet. I'm excited about it because apparently it's the best movie ever made. So,
it's a great drinking game movie, in my opinion.
So, yeah, I'm surprised we're doing another Venom after the second one. I thought it would have been like, oh, let's try and capture lightning in a bottle. And then, unfortunately, it didn't happen. And, you know, let's pay off on the post-credit scene with Woody Harrelson and Carnage. Yeah, but then I'm surprised they kept going. So, yeah, here we go, I guess.
I just want to know what happened with that Tom Holland post-credit scene. Like, I'm so like what? How does Venom tie into this Spider-Man? So many questions about everything involving Venom.
And why is Michael Keaton hanging out with Morbius for who knows why?
That was great. I'm telling you, rewatch that early trailer. It's totally different. Their interactions are totally different.
I don't. I mean, we've talked about
Morbius is a bad movie just all around. Just overall, Morbius, I think, is a bad movie. I honestly think Madam Web is way more entertaining than Morbius.
It's like comparing
Gotham to Gotham Knights.
Yeah, it's literally not.
We're not
comparing great films here.
So.
Oh, man. But yeah, that's good. It is comparing Gotham to Gotham Knights. It's actually a good analogy. But man, I don't know. I keep saying the only reason they keep doing this is because they don't want to lose Spider-Man, right? We keep saying that they keep making these movies.
But they don't have to keep making so many bad movies. They can just make like one bad movie every 5 years and it's fine.
Right.
They don't have to make like three every, you know?
It's not five every 1 year. It's one every 5 years.
You guys got this backwards.
We're going to get that Sinister Six movie eventually. I'm totally convinced we're gonna get it now. Huh?
Who's the Spider-Man gonna be?
That's what I don't know. They'll bring Miles in from the Spider-Verse, and that's what they'll do, right?
I only want them to do that if it's like Roger Rabbit and it's animated Miles, right? And it's live action people.
That would be awesome.
If they're gonna do something that stupid and ruin something, why don't they try at least to do something unique?
Well, don't let Avi Arad hear that, because he'll run with that.
He probably would. He's like, how do we not think this? We should steal Roger Rabbit and do it. I guess Sonic did it; it was successful. If they could do it for a video game, why can't I do it for the Spider-Man for the millionth time?
Oh man, I don't know. I mean, I feel bad. I just feel bad. But this,
I don't. Tom Hardy's getting paid, bro.
Yeah, no, yeah. I don't feel bad for the actors. I mean, they're obviously getting a check, so congratulations. But I feel bad for people who like these characters. This is good. I just feel bad for the people who like these characters. Like, I cringe to think what would have happened had Sony continued to make Spider-Man didn't come into the MCU and Sony continued to make Spider-Man movies.
I don't know. This is just like, this is Tom Hardy's version of Venom. Like, this is totally his like idea. He loves Venom. He loves doing this. Like, this is weird that this is like what he wants to do. In my opinion, it's weird he keeps doing this. It's weird he wants to do it. He loves it. Like, this version of Venom, I think, is just, it's such an unusual take on Venom, in my opinion. Because having Venom without Spider-Man is like unheard of. I'm like, what?
It is weird. It's very weird.
So for Tom Hardy to be so passionate about it is kind of interesting to me. Like, I would be, if they ever do a fourth one, I bet you he directs it.
Oh, God.
There's no way they bring this woman back to direct this movie. They're going to blame her for it.
Well, speaking of director, in the article, I think it said that she wrote the first two.
Yeah, she did.
So there actually is some consistency between the three, and maybe if we wanted to cross our fingers and toes, the writing and directing being under the same brain might pull something out that we haven't seen before. But
the last one was Andy Serkis's directorial debut, right?
That is correct. Yeah.
So I don't know. I guess this is hers as well. Like I don't know. It's not.
Yeah.
I didn't think Andy Serkis did a bad job.
I mean. It he didn't write it, so
hopefully he'll be in the Batman 2 more often now. Maybe he has
some he's got a little bit more time. Yeah, exactly.
Well, speaking of the Batman, I mean, obviously we all three of us love the Dark Knight trilogy. We all think it's one of the best trilogies.
Do we?
I love the why not?
The beef.
Dark Knight Rises, Mr. Holzman.
I think it's the weakest of the three, but I never said I didn't like it.
Okay.
I think that's the weakest of the three is not a hot take at all.
Right. Like, I don't think I'm saying anything crazy here.
Sounds like someone's got some beef.
No beef. This is no beef. But Mr. Nolan was speaking to Deadline, and one of the most famous quotes from the Dark Knight, he didn't write. So he says, I'm plagued by a line from The Dark Knight, and I'm plagued by it because I didn't write it. My brother Jonathan wrote it. It kills me because it's the line that most resonates. And at the time, I didn't even understand it. He says, you either die a hero or you live long enough to become the villain. I read it in his draft and I was like, all right, I'll keep it in there. But I don't really know what it means. Is that really a thing? And then over the years, since the films come out, it just seems truer and truer. In this story, it's absolutely that. Build them up, tear them down. It's the way we treat people. Obviously, that line is delivered by Harvey Dent in The Dark Knight. Well, I think that it might be my favorite line in the movie. I don't know. What do you guys think? What do you think about the quote and his take on it?
It cracks me up because it's just like, yeah, okay, your little brother got one on you and now you're jealous. Sure. You know, it's like, you're Chris Nolan. Give me a break. You know, Dark Knight, Inception, all these movies. Your brother's known for this quote and Westworld. Like, you know, not that Westworld's bad, but it's like, give Jonathan his moment, damn it. You know, but whatever. I think it's funny. It's cool. You know, I love the quote. I feel like, since the moment I heard it, I knew, like, you knew, like, this is going to be one of those quotes you hear for over and over again. And that's basically what it was.
Yeah.
Yeah. I guess I was somewhat surprised when I first read it. I was somewhat surprised that Chris didn't write it. But then I was like, okay, well, Jonathan is actually a very accomplished writer. So I was like, I guess that makes sense that he wrote it. But what surprised me about it, first of all, the line is amazing. I think about it like all the time. It's one of like, it's the thing that surprised me most about it is that it's such a strong theme in the movie. Like, clearly it's delivered by Harvey. Clearly that happens to his character. But then the noble lie at the end causes Harvey to maintain that. But Batman in the public eye becomes that, even though he's not that. Right. And just that switcheroo, at the end of the movie to really like give depth to that line, and the fact that the director that we all hail as, you know, the creator of this trilogy didn't even understand it when he first heard it is really surprising, because it's like, we, bro, this is your movie. Like, I don't know. It's a theme in the movie that you are directing and you didn't understand, you know, essentially what could be thought of as the thesis of the movie. So yeah, I think it gives credit to writers, which is nice. A little bit over directors sometimes. So yeah, it was surprising when I first heard it because he's the director. But then when I thought about it more, I'm like, I guess it makes sense that Jonathan wrote that banger of a line.
You know, it brings me back to one of the origins of the beef, where Eric told me that Nolan always thinks he's the smartest guy in the room. And yep. I think that story debunks it, because he didn't get it and it worked. And I'm just saying, you gotta get in with the old man, Nolan. He knows when he's beat.
Well, thinking you're the smartest guy in the room doesn't necessarily mean you are.
Clearly, he didn't think he was because he left the line. If he was the smartest, he would have said, hey, you're the little idiot. You got to cut it out. Let's go. Out of my movie. Just saying.
I don't know. I love the line. There's a lot of good lines in that entire trilogy, but I love that one. And I mean, I don't think his writing is the strongest part of him anyway.
No, it's definitely Jonathan's strength.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it doesn't surprise me that Chris didn't write it, and he would have been foolish to take it out. But it's just such a good line. And like Andrew said, it encapsulates the movie perfectly.
Foreshadowing. It's brilliant.
It's a brilliant line. So,
hey, I believe they like to call it cinema on the internet.
And that, I mean, hey, at least it's in your family, right? Like, it's someone in your family who wrote the line. So it's not like someone else. Like, Goyer wrote it, and he had to keep it in because Goyer wrote it, right?
I think Goyer should be more upset than Chris, to be honest, right? Goyer's the other scribe of that movie. Isn't it Goyer and Nolan?
Yeah.
The two who wrote that movie, I know it was Goyer and Chris for Begins, right? But I think it was Goyer and Jonathan for Dark Knight. I think, you know, Jonathan came in for Dark Knight, and he was there through Rises.
I think you're right. Mistaken,
you know? So.
Yep.
I actually didn't know about Jonathan till Dark Knight, because he wasn't a part of Begins.
Yeah, I didn't either until that. I mean, I didn't even know going in, until I only knew after the film when the credits came up. And then
the fact that they have two different accents really threw me for a loop.
Yep.
Yeah, true. Jonathan grew up here.
Yeah, yeah. Which always gets me, because I'm like, you guys look alike, but you sound so different. What's... I'm like, this is like tea and coffee. I can't figure it out.
Well, I think we've come to the end of this fine episode.
I want to thank you for ending it on Nolan, because I love Nolan, and I think it's a good. Nolan is like the cherry on top. Always is. He's fantastic. Nolan. I love Nolan. I can't help it. I love Nolan.
You sound like Brick right now from Anchorman.
I love Lamb.
I
love Nolan. Sure. I love Nolan. I love Rises. Screw you, Kowalski.
Like I said, it's a good movie. It's just the weakest of the three. I don't hate it by any stretch. I do not hate that movie.
All right, okay. let me go all Uxus on you.
It just has the most flaws, in my opinion. It has the most flaws of the three films.
Okay, all right.
And I mean, I admit The Dark Knight's a better movie, but I like Batman Begins more. So
don't try to butter me up.
That's just how I roll with the trilogy.
That's fine. That's how. What did you? You had an amazing Twitter quote the other day. What was it? You just dropped it. I was like, oh, this is so. Oh, rock with me. I loved it. Rock with me, tweet X fam. I was like, oh, this is the most wholesome thing I've read all day.
That's true. Rock with me.
Rock with me.
Yeah, that was when I asked the question, Andrew. I'll ask you. I don't know if you answered. You might have.
It's so wholesome.
Is there like a food that you like, but you don't like the fresh version of it? Like I said, I don't like tomatoes, fresh tomatoes. I don't eat fresh tomatoes, but I like salsa, ketchup, all of that. So is there anything like that for you? Cause Pete didn't answer. Cause he's just boring. But you,
because I'm sorry that I enjoy watermelon and watermelon candy. I suck.
Do you have anything like, it's just weird food things. I don't know.
Like, do you like carrots but hate carrot cake?
I feel like it's mostly the other way around for me. Like, it's like, oh, well, so like I grew up like with a lot of like kitty cocktails at bars and stuff. So like the maraschino cherries and stuff. So at one point, I'm like, oh, can you get cherries from the grocery store? Like, I'll just have the cherry. Like, I don't, you know. And then he brought home like regular cherries with the pits. And I'm like, the heck is this?
That's not what I want.
I just want sugar. That's like the, I guess that's the one example. Yeah, that's a bad example, but
I mean it just makes you more normal if you don't, because I feel it's one of the things in my life that I'm like, why do I not like watermelon but I like watermelon flavored things? Like, why?
Sugar.
Watermelon is delicious. How do you not like watermelon?
I don't know. I wish I knew. I don't know why. It's the consistency of it, and I don't know. I just,
it's like eating water. It's incredible.
Yeah, it's I don't like refreshing. It. I don't do it often, but when I do it, it's like, oh yeah, this is good.
Yeah. Are you like a cereal guy like Lauer? He looks like he would be a cereal guy.
I am a cereal guy.
That's great. I love it.
Maybe it's like a Midwest thing.
Maybe it is. I don't know. Maybe.
Yeah, maybe.
That's Garrett fantastic.
Told me like he because he I think he can't do like gluten and stuff. Yeah. So instead he'll slice his carrots and he'll put that in like a bowl of ice milk and he says it kind of tastes like a carrot smoothie. So
I think did not say like, that. You're full of crap.
He does the carrot chips and he puts them in ice milk and that's what he. That's
you're
he
lying. Does.
No,
I don't believe you.
He's vegan who can't do gluten. So.
Yeah, I don't believe that. I'm going to have to ask him because I don't believe you.
I wish you would ask. Yeah, yeah. He sent me a video. Like, apparently people are putting, like, making weird cereal thing. Like, they did it with fruit, but he told me, like, if you do it with carrots, it takes, like, a smoothie. So I was like, all right.
That sounds disgusting.
Carrots and ice milk. That's what Garrett likes to eat for breakfast.
Yeah, that's not true.
That sounds fake.
Well, I mean, you know, he's a big Kirk Cousins guy. Anything's possible.
Yeah, well, that is right? true. Right? He's a big Kirk Cousins guy.
Yeah, see, it's not that far off.
So, all right. Well,
have you had enough tonight?
I just wanted to thank Andrew for coming on the show.
Of course.
And yeah, I'm sorry this took so long, man. It was awesome to have you. It was great to have another perspective on the show. We always like having another perspective, and especially since it's one of our fans who listen to us and he knows the show and how we interact. You fit right in. It was perfect. You did not, you know, you didn't seem overwhelmed at all. So that's fantastic. But yeah, if you have anything you want to plug, man, go ahead. Plug away.
Nothing specific. If you want to follow me on Twitter with all the other bots that apparently follow me, it's my old last name, Meixner, Meixner, and then my first name, Andrew. Go ahead and follow me there. Say hi.
Oh, that's who you are.
Yeah.
That's yep. I know what it is.
Yeah, hi.
You Scrabble guy. I know that. Yeah, like I look at his name, I'm like, I can't pronounce this.
Yeah.
You might as well be like a hockey player from like the Czech Republic. Like, I'm like, I can't say this guy's name.
That's that.
All right.
Got an X. So
now I know who it is. I got a picture, I got a voice and a face. I can't you don't look anything like your default picture, I'll tell you that much.
Yeah, that's because it's Joaquin Phoenix from Joker, so.
It's like there you go. Like don't come at me. Like it's like how do you not know who this is? Well, he doesn't look anything like Joaquin Phoenix.
All right, Pete, your turn.
Socially at Pete Illustrated, @_@straight_O_G for the show. Instagram, Twitter, Facebook group, Facebook fan page. Batman, the Batman Book Club monthly, BatmanOnFilm.com, Batman on Film podcast all the time. @ Spidey Coalition for that podcast. That's cool. I got an episode coming up in a week or two. And that's really it. Just follow me everywhere. And you know, I just go on and I spread the word of Holzman across the country.
Okay. Thank you, as always.
Eric's reached his limit. There's no more stupidity tonight.
You guys know where to find me at Finale33 on Twitter, spell Finale33. If you, again, interested in the New York Knicks, I do a weekly live stream on every Wednesday at about 7 p.m. Eastern time called All Nicked Up. Twitter handle is @all_nicked_up, crossing my fingers that Jalen Brunson's not seriously hurt.
Season's over.
Oh, God, it was before that anyway. They had so many injuries, it's whatever. But
the Knicks nicked.
crossing my fingers that's not a serious injury and he'll be back. Soon. It doesn't seem like it is, but we'll see what happens there. As Pete mentioned, the Facebook group, Facebook fan page, interact with us on the Facebook fan page. I'll try and post some more of my craziness on there to get you guys to interact with us.
People are asking for lamb chop pictures, by the way. They want to see you cook lamb chops.
I've never cooked them. Oh, no, that's a lie. I have.
That's it. People are like, Eric got this new Instapot slow cooker thing. Where are the lamb chops? And I said,
my Ninja Foodie. I actually used it tonight. To make chili.
People want chili. So, people want pictures.
So I did. I put a picture up.
All right. Lamb chop chili. It's coming, guys.
Lamb chop chili. That's an interesting one.
You know, it's going to be gamey, but it'll be delicious.
It's the lamb. Well, lamb chops are not gamey, really.
They're a little greasy, I guess. Maybe I used the wrong word.
I love them.
They're so good. Yeah. I should smoke some lamb
chops. I was just about to say you should smoke some lamb chops.
I'm down for it. Lamb chops. Here we go.
All right.
Lamb chops play along. Right? Is that how that song goes? Or is it, this is a song that never ends. It took us on and on. Right? Am I
lamb chops? You are correct. We have to try it. We've been talking for years to do a cooking show with Bill. We have to kind of get that going.
Yeah.
I think that would be cool.
Yeah, let's do it.
All right. We'll
do gumbo.
We'll work on that.
We've eaten the gumbo. It's delicious.
Andrew, if you ever want to come back again, you just let us know. We would love to have you back on.
Absolutely.
This has been fantastic.
And there's a six-month waiting list.
I'm sorry it took so long, but I'm glad we finally got you on. So, yep. Again, my fault, but thank you. Thank you, man, for being patient and coming on the show. Yeah, it's been great. It's been a lot of fun.
It was a blast. Thank you guys so much.
All right. So for Andrew and Pete, I'm Eric. You're listening to Straight Outta Gotham, and we'll see you next time.
Booyah.